எப்படி அதுல வருது நீங்க பாக்குறீங்க யா செல் ஆனா ரெக்கார்ட் பண்ணிறீங்களா
இல்ல நார்மல் ரெக்கார்ட்
வீடியோ
இன்னே ரெக்கார்ட்
ஆலியா ரெக்கார்ட் பண்ணிறீங்களா
இல்ல நேரா ரெக்கார்ட் பண்றது நேரா ரெக்கார்ட் பண்றது சார் இது ஆட்டோமேட்டிக் ரெக்கார்ட்
சார் இது நேரா ரெக்கார்ட் இதல
பண்ணு ஐ வில் சென்ட் தி ரெக்கார்டிங் சார் சார் ஐ வில் சென்ட் தி ரெக்கார்டிங் ஐ வில் சென்ட் தி ரெக்கார்டிங்
இது நேரா பண்றது இல்ல ஸ்டூடண்ட்ஸ் எத்தனை பேர் உள்ள வந்திருக்காங்க
22
உள்ள வந்துட்டாங்களா மொத்தம் எத்தனை ஸ்டூடண்ட்ஸ்
60 சார் Akash, what happened to your application to Singapore?
Akash. I haven't got any reply yet, sir. Probably they'll take me.
Did you send a remind request? You have to pursue it, you know. You cannot simply apply and then wait. You have to send some reminder, you know. Not reminder, you cannot say a reminder. You have to send a mail saying that I'm waiting for your response or something. Because it's nearing, right? This, you are planning to go for summer, right?
I'll check about that, sir. I'll make sure I.
Okay, okay. Okay, shall we start, sir? 40th joint. Only three have projected their video. I do not know what happened to others. I will mark absent if you are not projecting your video. Please make sure that you are projecting your video. Okay. I have someone else monitoring also. It's not like a classroom. This is a guest lecture. And we have Dr. P.R. Lakshmi Narayanan from Annamalai University. He's a professor there. And he has been my mentor and well-wisher since I joined Annamalai University in 1994. And he's a quite a versatile person. And he has been doing research on casting initially. And he has evolved with the research topic. And now he's working on increasing the efficiency of engine, right? A truck engine. And he's focusing on the addition of chambers. He is going to explain more so that the efficiency of the engine gets better. Even a percentage increase in the efficiency of an engine is useful for the environment because you are trying to reduce the environmental loading due to fossil fuels. And he is trying to get it more than 10-20%. And his aim is to double the efficiency in due course of time. Of course, it's not a one day effort. He has been doing this for for the past several years, and that's why the topic for this session is evolution of ceramic engine. So the objective of this lecture is to throw some light on the evolution of the engine. How I am going to handle this for your course is to make the parts that evolve. The engine is evolving. He's going to throw some light on the evolution of the engine. So he kept adding parts to the engine. So in terms of metal casting, if you are designing a casting, right, you have a gating design, runner, riser, screw, and allowances, and so many other things put in to design a casting. So you should also consider the evolution of the casting in due course of time, because refinement happens in all the fields. Say for example, a television. Television used to be a bulky box before. Now you have thin films, which can also be folded. So the evolution has happened so much so that the product transformed from being a cumbersome lot to a simple part. So this lecture is going to show you the evolution of an engine. For us, it's going to be a part. Engine is a part. Consider engine as a part and how it has evolved. So your aim should be to observe the evolution of the part, and later higher order thinking perspective, we will be dealing with the evolution and so the design of the casting. So in the final assessment test, it's going to be like that. Right now we have an expert, Dr. P.R. Lakshmi Narayanan. As I have indicated, he has been with Annamalai University since long, almost 3 decades. Before that, he was with Sitar Vessels.
Yeah,
Sitar Vessels is a oil and manufacturing company.
And another 6 days, I will present it once more, then you can listen.
So it's a boiler manufacturing company which has plants across India. So he has been a design engineer, and then after putting 5-6 years of service there, he came to academics, and he has been doing a lot of research initially in casting. Now he has been working on developing ceramic engines, right? We have other participants also from Universal Carborundum Industry, Infer, there is another company that produces furnaces, and other PhD scholars also on the forum. So he's going to throw some light on the evolution of ceramic engines. So we will have 30 minutes, and then later, if you have any questions, you can ask, and then we will finish the session. Yes, sir, please. Your time, sir.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, students. Good morning, Padar. He has given me an introduction to me, right? Also, he gave an introduction how a part or a machine something evolves after so many stages. He also explained you with the simple example of a television. It was a box like thing, big box like thing earlier. Now it is a very thin film actually. So like that, we have also evolved at the present ceramic engine after 4 or 5 years. This particular design or design configuration or design or the engine arrangement has been evolved after 4 or 5 years of rigorous analysis and everything, right? So actually, we started this research work in 2016. I gave my first lecture on ceramic engines in PSC College of Technology during 2016 March, right? March or April. Now, after 4 or 5 years, we have arrived at this particular configuration, right? It has gone through several stages, like 7 or 8 stages, of which finally we have arrived at this configuration, right? Before entering into that, I will give you a small introduction about the ICE engines and the importance of this research for about 5 minutes, right? Actually, as all of you, as many of you know, all the present trucks, lorries, buses or heavy vehicles are running or having an efficiency somewhere around 30 to 35%, right? The brake thermal efficiency 30 to 35%. So our aim is to increase this efficiency to double fold, right? For example, if the efficiency is around 30 to 35%, we want to take it over 60 to 65%, right? This is presently the buses, lorry, the particular lorry or a heavy vehicle gives 4 kilometers a liter, right? It can, for 1 liter of diesel, it gives you 4 kilometers of mileage, and we want to increase to about 7 to 8 kilometers a liter, right? Actually, if you see in India, we are importing for about 5 lakh crores of rupees worth diesel every year, right? Out of which 80% of the diesel is consumed by heavy trucks, buses and lorries alone, right? That means nearly 4 lakh crores rupees worth diesel is spent on heavy trucks, lorries and buses alone. And only 1 lakh crore is spent on petrol, diesel for small vans, cars, two-wheelers, everything put together consume only 1 lakh crores of worth rupees diesel and petrol only, right? So nearly for 4 lakh crores worth rupees, heavy trucks and buses and lorries alone consume, right? And supposing we convert all the present lorries and buses and all for or upgrade into ceramic engines in future, right? And if we double fold the efficiency, that is, we increase the mileage nearly double fold, right? For example, the present lorry gives you around 4 kilometers a liter, and it may go up to 7 to 8 kilometers a liter, right? So that means we will be saving about 1.5 to 2 lakh crores of worth diesel every year, right? This is free for you, right? Yeah, every year it is going to come free only, right? So if you want to imagine what is this, the tune of this 1.5 lakh crores. Actually, in central government budget of India, the whole budget is only 20 lakh crores per year, right? Out of this, nearly 14 lakh crores goes for salary alone, salary and pension alone. In the remaining 6 lakh crores, after so many welfare schemes and everything, the available amount for investment is only 1.5 lakh crore per year, right? So to this tune, we can save the money through diesel economy, right? So 1.5 lakh crores, the investment budget that is possible in the central government, to that extent we can save through diesel savings alone, right? So this is the social impact of the project, right? So of course, this 1.5 lakh crores rupees will be available with the general public, but they will be able to invest on anything that is going to be fruitful, right? So this is the introduction. This is the situation on which we started thinking about ceramic engines, right? So in ceramic, see, normally, why we need ceramic engine, I'll tell you, right? So what is the present problem with the IC engine? Why it is giving low efficiency? Let us see, right? In the present IC engines, all of you know that liquid lubricant is used between piston and cylinder, right? So this liquid lubricant, if the material temperature of the engine goes above 140 degrees centigrade, then it will char, get sticky, and the piston and cylinder will cease, right? Or no more the engine will operate, right? So the whole culprit is the liquid lubricant and nothing else, right? So to keep the liquid lubricant temperature below 140 degrees centigrade, we are using radiator, right? This radiator cools the engine and keeps the material temperature below 140 degrees centigrade, right? So another thing is, see, in the radiator, if the material temperature goes beyond 100 degrees centigrade, then the radiator water will boil out and it will steam, right? So purposely people are not going for a material temperature of the IC engine beyond 80 to 85 degrees centigrade, right? In many cars, if you see in the dashboard, you'll see the temperature meter, right? So that will not show you above 80 or 85 degrees centigrade, right? The pointer will not show you above 80 or 85 degrees centigrade, right? So the material temperature is purposely kept below 85 degrees centigrade, right? So what happens? By cooling the engine, we are extracting so much of heat from the engine, right? To keep the engine temperature low, and it is simply sent to the atmosphere, right? So surprisingly, if you note, we are losing from 30 to 40% of the total heat input to the atmosphere through the radiator, right? So supposing you fire 1000 ml of liter or 1 liter of diesel, right? Out of which nearly 300 to 400 ml is going to the atmosphere simply by heat loss through the atmosphere, right? So what we are trying to do is we want to cut off this radiator itself, right? So by cutting down the radiator itself, what will happen? You cannot use the liquid lubricant, right? So the liquid lubricant, so we want to cut off the liquid lubricant also, right? This is what we thought of, and this was our first spark on the ceramic, this particular high efficient engine design, right? And what we are thinking of is, see, supposing we want to avoid the radiator, thereby we want to avoid the liquid lubricant. First, what we thought was, instead of liquid lubricant, we can go in for solid lubricant, right? So solid, as all of you know, that graphite is a solid lubricant. We thought that we will put as a graphite liner inside the cylinder, and if you operate, the graphite liner will act as solid lubricant, and the piston will reciprocate up and down, right? So this is what we thought. And now from this position, I will enter into the PPT. So you will all come, I will explain stage by stage how we arrived at the present configuration. Pull the first slide. First. Good. Pada, are you able to see the this one PPT? Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Title pages.
Okay. Good. So actually, so this is the hand sketch made by me in 2015 or beginning of 2016, right? So this is the first arrangement thought by me, right? So here, what we thought was to have a, see, the cylinder is having a graphite liner here, right? This graphite liner, right? And this piston, we wanted to replace it by titanium or inconel, right? Because and we wanted to avoid the liquid lubricant itself totally here. And this graphite liner will serve as solid lubricant, right? So this is what the arrangement we thought, right? But the problem later on we realized that, see, supposing all of you know that, see, this connecting rod, you know, it will sway this side and that side, right? So as the crank rotates, the connecting rod will sway both ways, right? Like a pendulum, right? So what happens is, because of this sway, the piston will slap on right side and left side alternatively, right? So this, it will create a heavy lateral force. The piston will create a heavy lateral force on the graphite liner, right? But the problem with the graphite liner is graphite liner cannot withstand that heavy shock, right? Or lateral shock, right? So what we thought was, okay, this graphite, this particular design is not okay. And what we have also assumed here is, surrounding the graphite liner, you can see that where it is insulated, right? So ceramic cylinder is placed, our surrounding that insulation is placed, right? So the, of course, the ceramic cylinder will back up the graphite liner, but still it cannot take up the lateral shock created by the slapping of the piston, right? and we are totally insulated, right? So that no heat is lost to the atmosphere, and we are straight away saving the heat loss through the radiator. That is around 30 to 40% of the total heat input. That will be straight away the increasing the efficiency of the engine, right? Okay, so I will go to the next sketch, right? So here, see, this is the titanium or inconel. We have replaced the aluminium piston by titanium or inconel piston, right? And we have placed a graphite liner here surrounding the piston, right? And ceramic cylinder is also here, and then it is finally insulated, right? This is the expanded view or the localized view of the cylinder and the piston, right? And this is the gudgeon pin of the piston, right? This is the gudgeon pin. And I'll go to the next slide now. So this is how the piston looks, right? We are placing graphite liner here, right? Surrounding between the gudgeon pin and the piston, piston hole that is having that gudgeon pin inside. In between, we have a graphite bush. Why the graphite bush is placed is because as we have totally avoided the liquid lubricant, now the material temperature will rise as high as 800 or 850 degrees centigrade, right? So you cannot have liquid lubricant between the gudgeon pin and the piston also, and so the graphite bush is used, right? Of course, this graphite bush can withstand, but the graphite liner surrounding the piston cannot withstand because of the lateral slapping that is taking place when the crankshaft sways, when the connecting rod sways, right? I'll go to the next slide now. So this is, see, all of you know that ceramic material is a brittle material, and see, once you have slapping on left and right like this, see, the graphite liner also will break, as well the ceramic cylinder also will break, right? It cannot take such shock loads, right? As all of you know, ceramic material is highly brittle and it cannot take shock loads, right? To avoid that, what we have done is, see, we have taken two mild steel or stainless steel half sleeves like this, right? It is bolted to there, and we are clamping, and we will apply a particular amount of torque with the help of a system called torque wrench. With the torque wrench, you can apply a particular amount of torque on the bolts. By applying the particular amount of torque on the bolts, we apply compressive stress, compressive loading on the ceramic cylinder, right? So that is when the bolts are tightened, the ceramic cylinder will be under compression and it will have compressive hoop stresses developed in it, right? So now, as the firing takes place inside the graphite cylinder liner, here, see, at the center, when firing takes place, it will apply a tensile forces on the ceramic cylinder, right? So this tensile forces the compressive stresses that are already set up by tightening the bolts will offset this tensile stress, and the tensile stresses will be minimum, right? So also, this is called pre-stressing of the ceramic cylinder, right? By pre-stressing means, even before the start of the engine, there will be a stress produced on it, right? So pre-compressive stresses will be there, and these pre-compressive stresses will offset the tensile stresses produced by produced during the power stroke or the explosive stroke of the engine, right? So by this way, we can see that the ceramic cylinder can withstand the shock load, right? And also, see, supposing the compressive stresses are, say, 40 megapascals, or sorry, 40 newton per meter square, or sorry, say 10 kg per centimeter square or something like that, then and your tensile stresses are going to be 20 kg per centimeter square, then after offsetting, totally a resulting 10 kg per centimeter square tensile stress will be there, right? So here what happens, half of the tensile stress is offset, and the remaining of the tensile stress is allowed to attack the ceramic cylinder, right? So this 10 kg per centimeter square tensile stress, that what is produced here, maybe less than the design stress, that may be around 20 kg percent in square, right? So by this way, what we are doing is we are trying to reduce the thickness of the ceramic cylinder, right? So why we want to reduce the thickness of the ceramic cylinder? See, why if the thickness doubles, then your thrust tonnage is increasing square of the times, that is 4 times, right? So if the thickness is doubled, say if the thickness of the ceramic cylinder is say 20 mm or 25 mm, then your thrust tonnage is, let us assume, say 3000 tons. Then if the thickness doubles, say it becomes 50 mm thickness ceramic cylinder, then your tonnage required for the press may be 6000 tons or 7000 tons, like that, right? So it will be very it will be increasing enormously, and actually it will increase by 4 times, right? So if your thrust tonnage initially it is say for 20 to 25 thickness it is 1500 tons, then for a double fold thickness, say for 50 mm, it may be 6000 tons or 7000 tons. Then your thrust tonnage will be very heavy, and the cost of the thrust also will be very heavy. That is why, looking at all these angles, we have seen that the ceramic cylinder is pre-compressed and it is offsetting the tensile stress produced in during the power stroke or explosion stroke, right? You want to ask one another question? Okay, now this is the next thing. What see? Now the piston is having the graphite bush in between the gudgeon pin and the titanium piston. Surrounding that, we have in this design, what you have done is, as the graphite liner cannot withstand the stresses, what we felt was, okay, let the piston be in direct contact with the ceramic cylinder, right? See, here we are not using solid lubricant. See, we thought that ceramic metal is highly hard, highly hard, and so it will not wear out that easily, right? So it cannot be scratched that easily. So it is very, very hot, whereas titanium is soft actually, or it is also having sufficient amount of hardness. So hot to hot, when the sliding takes place, that easily wear will not takes place, and it will have long life, like that we thought, right? And so we removed the graphite liner because it cannot withstand the lateral slapping of the piston. So we thought this particular arrangement, right? Then we went to the next stage of improvement. See, this is what the next stage of improvement thought by us, right? So what we felt was, below this particular guide, you know, here in this part, I am showing with the cursor at the bottom of the sketch. This is the conventional aluminium piston that is available in the conventional engine, right? So what we tried to do was, between the conventional piston and the conventional cylinder, there will be liquid lubricant. We have left it as such. We are not disturbing at all, right? And there are piston rings also, that also we have not disturbed, right? So what we have done is, only we have attached a piston rod, right, which is made up of stainless steel, right? And we have attached it here with the conventional piston. We have lifted it up, right? And over at the top of the piston rod, we have placed one more piston, right? So two pistons will be there. And the top one is a hot piston, and the bottom one is a cold piston. See, what we have done is, the firing which was earlier here, just in the conventional engine, just above the conventional piston, firing was taking place earlier. Now it is shifted to hot zone, right? So this piston is also a stainless steel piston. Though I have written it as inconel piston, that is all later stage. Now we are going for prototype one. In prototype one, we are using stainless steel piston rod, and stainless steel cylinder, right? So why we are doing it like this is, we cannot go straight away to ceramic cylinder, because ceramic cylinder, if you want to produce a ceramic cylinder of a particular thickness, and if you change the design, then that whole die system has to be changed. that and it involves heavy amount of losses, right, or expenditure. That's why what we thought was, we'll initially go in for stainless steel, where we limit the temperature of the engine to 650 degrees centigrade, right? In this case, we'll increase efficiency by around 10 to 15%, right? So the present efficiency is around 30 to 35%, and we are around 35%, and we want to take it over 50%, right? Okay, please listen. See, this particular attachment of the cylinder was not straight away thought of. The purpose of attaching this top cylinder was earlier different, right? Why we thought of this particular configuration was, see here, all of you see, here what we wanted was, see, if you use graphite liner or if you use ceramic cylinder straight away with the piston, see, that will be wear taking place, and we wanted to study the tribological properties or wear properties, right? So we wanted to see how the wear will take place, right? So we wanted to study how the wear rate between the piston on the piston and on the ceramic cylinder will be there, right? So but what happened was, we could not get the ceramic cylinder or the liner, ceramic liner, for this particular to suit to the conventional piston size, right? So the conventional piston size was about 73.5 mm or 73 mm, whereas the ceramic liner, the standard ceramic liner, what was being manufactured by Cumi was having somewhere around 60 mm, right? There was a difference in ID, right? So what the situation has become like that. Now I cannot install this ceramic liner over this particular the conventional piston, right? And I cannot do the sliding wheel study, right? So what I thought was, we will lift it up like this, and still what we will have the ceramic cylinder here, and we will have the inconal or titanium piston for which we want to study the sliding wheel. And what we thought was, we will operate it for some 8 hours or 10 hours or 100 hours like that, and we will measure the ODE of the ceramic cylinder, ID of the ceramic cylinder and ODE of the inconal or titanium piston, and we will see what is the wear that has taken place, right? So the whole system arrangement was thought by adding another piston over the conventional piston was thought of only to do the sliding wear test, right? And later on, it became advantageous for us in so many aspects, and we adopted that particular design, right? So this particular arrangement was thought of only to study the sliding wear, and it was not thought of on the basis of combustion or efficiency like that, right? And see, now how it became advantageous, I tell you now, right? See the ceramic cylinder here surrounding the top hot piston. Now it is going being in prototype one. We are making it this out of stainless steel, right? The ceramics instead of ceramic cylinder, we are using a stainless steel cylinder, right? So this stainless steel cylinder and the stainless steel piston will reciprocate up and down inside the stainless steel cylinder, right? So what we are doing is, see, we have shifted the, see, what we thought was, then we thought of, okay, now we will place a guide bush like this, right? As I am showing you the cursor, just above the conventional piston, right? This guide bush is guiding the piston rod, right? So if a piston rod is guided like this, we thought that between the top piston, if it is guided perfectly, then the top piston will not have wear over the ceramic liner or the graphite liner, right? So actually, we don't need liquid lubricant or solid lubricant, because see, if you are guiding it perfectly here between the top piston and between the cylinder, there will be a small gap, right? and there will be no physical contact taking place there at all, right? Because of this, what will happen? So if you maintain a very close gap here, when the piston slides up and down, there will be no wear taking place at all, right? And we have avoided totally the friction here, right? So this is our first invention that made our design, we felt it is going to be, it gave us an immense amount of courage. And what we thought was, after studying all the sliding wear and everything, we thought of going in for ceramic engine, right? Now, we have preponed the entire research by 2 years, preponed, please listen. We have preponed the research by 2 years. We thought of earlier, we'll go in for ceramic engine design and all in 2024 only. Whereas now in 2022 itself, we'll go in for ceramic engine, right? Because we thought that there will be, we now come to a conclusion that without the physical contact, we will be able to have this configuration, right? See, the shift of firing here, the firing which was taking place here has been shifted over the hot piston at the cylinder head, right? So here, there is a chance for slight leakage through the gap, right? There is a chance, but we will see that, we will troubleshoot it after the prototype one is commissioned, right? There are certain ways to avoid the leakage, and we'll try that and troubleshoot it after we have commissioned it, right? So now this is the first confidence. With this arrangement, we arrived at the first confidence that ceramic engine may be a success. And I'll go to the next configuration now. Then we thought that, okay, see this sliding the piston rod, see the conventional piston is at the bottom and the conventional engine is here surrounding the conventional piston. The crankcase is shown here, right? And the piston rod is like this. At the top, there is a top piston, right? And what we are doing is, we are adding a top piston and a top cylinder, and in between, there will be an intermediate insert, right? So in the intermediate, see, the intermediate insert is mounted through over four tie rods, right? And actually, if you insert the finger, from front side, it will go to the rear side, right? Yeah, surrounding this all gap only, right? It's all gap only, right? So what we thought was, okay, we'll have the graphite bush, right? Yeah, graphite bush, or two half graphite bushes, two half sleeves of graphite bushes that will be surrounding the piston rod, right? And it will be kept compressed by two ball pins, right? Ball pins, right? Okay, so here what we have is, see, this is a ceramic liner. Surrounding that there is a liner, just a metal liner, and the metal liner is having a small spherical cavity, right? In that, a small spherical ball will sit, and it is kept compressed from the side, right? It is bolted tight, right? From this also it is bolted tight. So these two bushes are kept in position by the spherical pins, right? So actually, what will happen when the piston goes up and down? So the graphite bush will give the solid lubrication, right? So this is how we thought. And in this also, there are certain drawbacks because the reciprocation is going to be at a very fast rate, right? Because when the engine speed is as high as 1800 RPM, so the piston rod will go up and down by 1800 times, right? So whether this will be able to withstand, the graphite bush will be able to withstand this much amount of shock and vibrations, we had a doubt. So we went to the next configuration, right? So what we thought was, instead of having graphite bush, see, in this arrangement, we thought of two bearings, right? Four bearings. So see, in the plan view, if you see, the top view, if you see, okay, one bearing is here, one another here, another here, another here. Four bearings are there. So these four bearings are kept in contact with the piston rod. So what will happen? The piston rod will be simply guided by these four bearings, right? So when it goes, when the piston rod goes up, bearing will rotate in one direction, and when it comes up, it will reverse in direction, right? So we are having bearings of small bearings, which are enclosed bearings, which will run at 33,000 RPM, right? So at such a high speed it can run. What we thought was we can just cool it with a fan here in this in-between area alone. So four bearings will guide, right? So then we had yet another doubt. See, if there is only one bearing and one piston is on top and another piston is on the bottom, if there is slapping of the piston on the bottom one, in the bottom one, what will happen? The whole piston rod will also slap on the top also. So we went to the next arrangement, right? So see, these four bearings are kept as three-dimensionally as shown here. This the bottom one is conventional piston and top one is hot piston and four bearings are here, right? So next arrangement what we thought was, see, to have two bearings on in the plane of the screen, right? So two here and two on the other side, four bearings are here. So if you see in the top view, see two bearings are here, one below the other, and the other side, left side, two bearings are one below the other. Whereas on the other side, see at 90 degree to this, see in this plane, that is in the plane perpendicular to these two planes, these four bearings, there are two bearings at the center, right? One at the, see in between the top and bottom bearing at the center, in the 90 degree plane, we have one bearing at the front and one bearing at the rear, right? So totally we have six bearings, and if there is any slapping in the bottom piston, now what will happen? So this is now becoming, this piston rod becomes like simply supported beam, and so no more slapping will be there, right? Either the conventional piston will be allowed to slap or the top piston will be allowed to slap, right? So we are now totally avoided slapping. As well, we will cool these bearings with the help of a force draft fan, and these bearings will be kept cool. Whereas, see, I'll go to the next slide. See here, this particular intermediate insert, you know, this insert without bearings at all, the weldment skeleton will be like this, right? So first what we thought of, we'll place channels like this to support the bearings and everything. But we have got so many drawbacks in mounting them, so we went to the next arrangement, right? If you see this, you will see four bearings here, one here, on all four sides you have four bearings, right? They are supported by two gussets, right? One pillar we have at the center between the top and bottom plank, and two gussets are mounted either side, right? So like this, we have four bearings on four sides. So then we went to the next stage of thinking. Here what we do, see, in the top view, if you see at the center there is one pillar, right? Here this is one, is in the elevation, if you see, this is the top flank, this is the bottom flank. Connecting these two, we have a pillar. That pillar is this one, which I am showing with the cursor on the top view, right? So like this, on four sides, four pillars are there, right? So these four pillars on either side, we have two gussets. And these two gussets will be bolted to the pillars, right? And these two gussets on the near to the piston rod, the bearings will be mounted, right? Like this, two bearings on right side and two bearings on the left side, one at the front side and one at the rear side. Totally six bearings are there, right? So with six bearings, we can perfectly align, we can perfectly guide the piston rod top and bottom as it reciprocates. And there will be perfectly no slapping on the top piston, or there will be no slapping on the conventional piston, right? This is how we arrived at the present design configuration or arrangement of the system, right? And if you see here, without the gusset and all, the intermediate insert, the weldment will be like this. This is the top flange, this is the bottom flange. If you see in the plan view, see, these four are the pillars which are connecting the top and bottom flange. These are the two holes on which two gussets, one on either side, will be mounted, right? And the other end of the gusset, bearings will be mounted, right? Here at the, this is the axis of the piston rod, right? At the center. See, this will be the piston, how the piston assembly arrangement will be looking like. It is like this. This is the top piston. This is the piston rod. First, we thought that the piston rod can be connected to the conventional piston with the footstep arrangement like this, right? Either on top and bottom, right? Now, then we are changed this design also, and we thought that a simple cap will be sufficient on top and bottom to connect it to the top piston and to the bottom, weld it to the top and top piston and bottom piston. See, this is how the kind of piston rod is welded to the top piston, and top piston arrangement is like this. We have a top car flange, top car plate like this, and bottom car plate like this, and the piston side wall is going to be like this. We are welding all these things together. At the center, we have a support pin so that when the explosion takes place, as the top cover, the top end plate will be at very high temperature, it will not bend, right? Because strength will come down, so we are linking it with the connecting pin, supporting connecting pin, so that it will not bend that easily, right? So we went to the next arrangement, that the bottom bottom of the piston rod is connected to the conventional piston like this. Then this is the drawing, this is a handmade drawing, and this is what is made by our research scholar whose name is Ravina, right? She is my full-time research scholar. She made this drawing with scale and sketch pens, right? This is the arrangement first she has ever made. Then, see, this is a top cylinder attachment. At the bottom, we have a projection. This projection, see, this will go and get seated onto the top flange, right? See, if you see here, the top cylinder has entered here, right? So, like that, the intermediate attachment has entered the crankcase here, right? So, these are all done to see that the whole thing is perfectly aligned. For alignment purposes, we see that one is getting inserted into the other, right? So, this is the final configuration we arrived at, and this is the top cylinder head we had here over the conventional engine, the same cylinder head which is made up of aluminium, we are mounting it here. Of course, heat transfer would be here, so we don't think it will melt down that easily. Even at we have got a lot of fins over the this particular cylinder head, so I don't think the temperature of this cylinder head will become beyond 200 or 250 degrees centigrade. Why we are using this cylinder head, the old cylinder head itself, because once we go in for stainless steel cylinder head, we will have to make so many machining things and all here, like holes for piston rod, walls to come, walls to be machined. All those things need very accurate machining. So to avoid all those things and to see whether first of all the system is working satisfactorily or not, even see by here some heat loss will be there. Of course, surrounding the top cylinder wheel is completely insulated. Right, no heat loss will be there surrounding the top cylinder. Some heat loss will be here, right? But the whole thing is now, we hope that only 10% of the heat will be lost through this intermediate insert on this top head, right? So, restart now. Wait an hour. So with all the we hope that only we will lose more, we will not lose more than 10% of the heat through this top cylinder head and through this intermediate arrangement. Yet we hope that we have a chance for improving the entire efficiency by around 15% at least, right? The only problem that may arise is some leakage through this, right? But we have got certain solutions to solve it. And after commissioning it, based on the amount of leakage, we'll try to solve it, right? So now the session is over. Now the students are invited to raise any doubts or clarifications they have got.
Video. Yeah, thank you, sir. Actually, you have many parts. Yes. Developed and in order to construct the engine. So it's not a simple engine as you see in a two-stroke or four-stroke engine. He has evolved. That's why I thought to bring this before you. So it has been evolving since 2015. Yeah. And now it has reached some shape. Right, and he has to characterize it with the test rig. So he has bought two engines, similar engines, and one will be for a prototype and the other for testing setup. So it's not a simple procedure for an engineer to come out with products. It takes time and sitting on the bench and putting all your ideas together and evolving. And now you have to think this as a part, right? And then come out with a design for casting purposes. So if you have any questions on the evolution, its performance, as he has suggested, it can go up to twofold efficiency. So that's a good number. He says, if we have that, there will be a lot of reduction in the wastage. So if you have any questions, you can ask him.
Anybody can ask any question, please. Any student, any doubt if you have, you can please raise it now.
So while our government is not promoting diesel engines because it says it pollutes a lot, but if we see for the heavier vehicles, electric is not an option. And then we come across such invention that can actually increase the efficiency twice. So sir, when can we expect this actually put into practice?
Actually, I tell you, your doubt is that why can't we go in for electric engines, electric motor vehicles, right?
Yes, sir.
That is a basic problem in that. See, if you go in for electric motor vehicles, definitely these fellows will reduce the price of the diesel also, right? So, it is not a solution. One more thing is there. I tell you, basically there is a very, very important thing to listen in this. Diesel, as all of you know, it is coming, it is extracted from crude oil, right? From crude oil, you get petroleum, diesel, tar, everything, right? Bituminous tar, everything, right? So, from the crude oil, another important byproduct is fertilizer, right? This fertilizer, whether you need, as all of you know, this fertilizer is only feeding the entire masses today, right? So, crores and crores of people are fed by this fertilizer. And without fertilizer, you cannot do anything, right? Whether you use diesel or not, for fertilizer production at least, you have to use crude oil, right? So this crude oil, once you start producing fertilizer, diesel also will be coming, that you have to use it, right? So if you feel that your electric vehicle will solve the problem, then what will happen? Then whatever diesel that is coming out will become a waste and you have to use it necessarily, right? So the oil companies will reduce the price of diesel, right? Diesel cannot be removed from the system, from our life cycle at all, right? So, and one more thing, in another 40 years, this crude oil will get completely utilized, right? So after 40 or 50 years, crude oil will not be available and diesel will not be available, right? So if diesel is not available, then you will not have fertilizer to feed this entire masses, right? So in another 40 to 50 years, you cannot go in for natural fertilizer also, right? Natural fertilizer can feed only half the population, right? So once this crude oil is over, there no more is available, you cannot feed this entire population and you can feed only 50% of the population, right? So what we are trying to do is, now we want to bring down the cow slowly, right? So we want to increase the diesel engine efficiency and bring down the diesel consumption, thereby bringing down the fertilizer production also. Simultaneously, population also has to be brought down in another 20 to 30, within another 20 years or 30 years, the population has to be brought to half of it, right? So if the population of India is 140 crores today, it has to come down to 70 crores. Otherwise, we cannot feed the entire masses, right? And we have to bring down the diesel consumption, we have to bring down the fertilizer consumption. So only then we can extend the availability of diesel or petrol or your fertilizer for another, this fertilizer can last for another 40 years, it can be extended up to 70 years, right? So this is the basic problem, right? And electric vehicle is not at all the solution. I tell you, tar is not also going to be available. If tar is not available, you cannot lay the roads. what are you going to do with the electric vehicle? Who asked this question?
Definitely. Me, sir, Bharat Sharma.
I get it, sir. It's a different perspective. What are you going to do with electric vehicle if tar is not there and electric roads are not there?
Yes, sir. There'll be no roads to drive on.
Electric vehicle is not the solution at all, I tell you.
Thank you, sir. It was a different perspective to hear from that to from an expert point of view. Thank you.
See, there are so many feasible solutions. So, possible solutions, only a few will be feasible. See, the idea of this project is to extend the way we consume, right, diesel or even crude oil. So electric vehicle is a solution. In the US, they produced the first electric vehicle in 1956. US produced the first electric vehicle in 1956. Still now, they are not able to implement a standard procedure. They cannot replace the fossil fuel. Why? So many factors. For example, the technology, battery technology is not mature. You need copper, and we are closing down all the copper smelting industries because it is polluting, right? So there are so many factors involved in it. So let us not go in deep detail that. So efficiency, increasing efficiency is one way of extending the process.
And extending the availability of diesel for further 20 or 30 years.
Yes, instead of depleting it in 10 years, you leave it for next 25 years. If you increase
instead of depleting it within 40 years, you will deplete it after 70 years. Yes.
Any other questions?
Any other question? Sir. Related to the engine design, you may please ask.
Yes. Sir, what material do you say is just used in the which ceramic material is used, sir, in this design that you mentioned, and whether any other ceramic materials can be used as a substitute?
This ceramic material will have 99.6% purity aluminium oxide. Al2O3 chemical formula.
Aluminium oxide.
Aluminium oxide. Yes, it is made up out of powder metallurgy technique.
Are you going to make it in-house, sir, or you're going to buy it
Actually, Carbonum Universal, Murugappa Industries Group, Cumi Industrial Ceramics Division is supplying us.
Okay.
They are supplying all these things free of cost to us.
Carbonum Universal will make the cylinder and...
Cylinder, that's why I told you, if you go in for ceramic cylinder, the issue is if you change the design for each design or thickness, you will involve the changing the die itself, right? So yes, it is costing very high, right? That is why we are not straight away going into ceramic engine. First of all, we want to establish whether this, how the leakages are there between the piston, hot piston and hot cylinder. All these things we want to solve, and then we want to enter into the ceramic engine.
Correct. Any other questions quickly, or we can close the session.
Sir, one question regarding the weight, sir. Will it become heavy if we use ceramic?
Definitely. See, earlier we had only one piston. Now one more piston has come. And because of this, moving masses have increased more than two times, right? Because of this, what will happen? The dynamic balancing will be upset, and heavy dynamic forces will be set up, and heavy jolting will be there in the engine, right? Vibrations will be heavy. We have to see that all these things are kept within limits. And that's why we have made the top piston as thin as possible, that is 2 to 3 mm thickness only.
Yes, sir, thank you.
Any other question, please?
Okay. So if you don't have any question, we'll stop here. Thank you for joining us, sir, and elucidating the advantages of ceramic engine and its evolution. So I hope we will have a fruitful solution to this diesel crisis probably in a year or two. The first prototype at least you are expecting in 2022. So we will see.
Prototype we'll one, we expect, 22 we expect, and 23 we expect the prototype two.
Okay, great, great. That would be great. And I hope by the time we will have some fruitful engine running.
Yes, yes.
So thanks for being with us, sir. And thank the students for switching on the videos and being
thanks live. Thanks all, sir, for patient listening. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you. You can leave. You can go to the next class. Thanks. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you.